Welcome to Virtual Classroom. Today's topic is Healthcare Worker Safety During COVID-19 Pandemic. So, 28th April 2020, World Day for Safety and Health at Work. WHO declared this day on World Day for Safety and Health at Work. The World Health Organization calls upon all government, employers and workers organizations and the global community to take urgent measures for strengthening countries' capacities to protect occupational health and safety of health workers and emergency responders, respect their rights to decent working conditions, and develop national programs for occupational health of health workers and to provide them with occupational health services. Amid the COVID-19 pandemic, ILO has dedicated World Day for Safety and Health at Work 2020 in addressing the outbreak of infectious diseases at work, in particular on the COVID-19 pandemic. So health workers infected with COVID-19 pandemic following exposures in the workplace should have the right to employment injury benefit for occupational disease, including compensation, rehabilitation, curative services. Health workers are at high risk of violence all over the world. Between 8% and 38% of health workers suffer physical violence at some point in their careers. Many more are threatened or exposed to verbal aggression and social stigma because of their work. So health workers are the front line of any outbreak response, and as such are exposed to hazards that put them at risk of infection with an outbreak pathogens, in this case COVID-19. Hazards include pathogen exposure, long working hours, psychological distress, fatigue, occupational burnout, stigma, and physical and psychological violence. So before going into detail, we should know about the infection chain. Infectious agents are bacteria, virus, fungi, protozoa, parasites. And the reservoir of these infectious agents are people, equipment, and water. And the portal of exit from this reservoir are through excretion, through secretion, through droplet, and mode of transmission is by contact, droplet, airborne infection, or vector-borne diseases. Portal of entry, it may be respiratory tract, GI tract, mucous membrane, skin. Susceptible hosts are people with chronic disease, immunocompromised, very young or elderly. So in this way, the infection chain is maintained. And the standard precautions, particularly in hospital setting, includes the hand hygiene, personal protective equipment, sharp handling and disposal, cleaning of shared patient equipment, use of aseptic technique, respiratory hygiene and cough etiquette, routine environmental cleaning, safe handling and disposal of wastes, and use linen safely. So these are the means which are taken in the majority of the cases in the hospital setting. But in the community level in particular, there are some safety protocols which should be followed stringently. Quarantine separates and restricts the movement of the people who are exposed to a contagious disease to see if they become sick. Isolation separates sick people with the contagious disease from people who are not sick. Social distancing, also called physical distancing, means keeping space between yourself and people outside of your home. lockdown, it's a popular version of the quarantine during the coronavirus pandemic. A lockdown is a bigger measure to contain people from leaving home. A lockdown usually allows essential supplies, grocery stores, and pharmacies to be functional. Curfew. A curfew is a strict mandate that keeps people off the streets. Non-compliance to a curfew rule can lead to a fine or even arrest. Health workers' rights include the employers and the managers of the healthcare facilities should assume overall responsibility to ensure all necessary preventive and protective measures, provide information, instruction, and training on occupational safety and health, provide adequate IPC measures, that is infection prevention and control measures, and PPE, personal protective equipment supplies, familiarize personnel with technical updates on COVID-19, provide a blame-free environment for workers, enable cooperation between management and workers. What are the duties and responsibilities of the health workers? They should follow established occupational safety and health procedure, use provided protocols to assess, triage, and treat patients with respect, compassion, and dignity, maintain patient confidentiality, timely reporting, follow IPC measures and PPE rules, personal care, and reporting of own ailment. What the healthcare workers? Healthcare workers include all paid and unpaid persons serving in healthcare setting who have the potential for direct or indirect exposure to patients or their infectious secretion and materials. For example, this includes the doctors, nurses, laboratory workers, facility or maintenance workers, clinical trainees, and volunteers. There are two types of exposure. One is high-risk exposure, another is low-risk exposure. What is high-risk exposure? It means the close contact with the person with COVID-19 in the community. Providing direct patient care for a patient with COVID-19 without using PPE or not performing appropriate hand hygiene after their interaction. Having contact with the infectious secretion from a patient with COVID-19 or contaminated patient care environment without using PPE or not performing appropriate hand hygiene. These are high risk exposure. What is low risk exposure? Contact with a person with COVID-19 having not met the criteria for high risk exposure, that is brief interaction with the COVID-19 patient in the hospital or in the community. So whenever there is contact with the persons with COVID-19, what should we follow? This is the algorithm. And if there is symptoms of COVID-19, then restrict from work and test for COVID-19. If positive, then they should be treated as a case. Case management rule should be followed. If negative, find out the exposure risk level. If it is high, whether it is high risk exposure or low risk exposure. If it is low risk exposure, self-monitoring for 14 days after last exposure, no restriction from work. They should continue their work. If they develop symptom like fever or other symptoms, then they should restrict from the work and test for COVID-19. And if the test is negative and symptom resolved, they should go back to their work. If positive, they should be taken as case and should follow stringently the case management protocol. If there is high risk exposure, active monitoring, that is the monitoring should be done by the authority, and they should be restricted from the work. The personnel should be restricted from the work for 14 days after last exposure and look for whether he develops symptom or like fever or other symptoms. If no, then they can return to work. If yes, then test for COVID-19. If they are negative, they should be again monitored for another 14 days to see whether he develops symptoms or not. If he doesn't develop symptom, he can return to work. If he develops symptoms, then test for COVID-19 again positive, then they should be considered as case, and then the case management protocol should be followed. Whenever there is widespread community transmission, then they reinforce the need for standard precaution for all patient encounters. It should be reinforced. And they stress the importance of hand hygiene, cough etiquette, and respiratory hygiene. Enforce social distancing between healthcare workers and patient when not involved in direct patient care. Instruct all healthcare workers at the facility to report recognized exposure. Have staff regularly self-monitor for fever or symptom. Remind the staff to avoid reporting to work when ill. When resources are available, instruct staff to wear a medical mask at all times when in the facility as an additional protective measure to limit potential spread among staff and to patients. So when the healthcare worker should return to work, return of work of infected symptomatic healthcare workers. There are two strategies which are follows. One is symptom-based strategy, another is test-based strategy. In symptom-based strategy, the healthcare worker should be excluded from work until at least 3 days, 72 hours have passed since recovery. Defined as, what is recovery? Defined as resolution of fever without the use of fever-reducing medication. And improvement in respiratory symptom, particularly cough or shortness of breath, and at least 10 days have passed since symptoms first appeared. And another strategy is test-based strategy. The healthcare worker should be excluded from work until resolution of fever without the use of fever-reducing medication, improvement in the respiratory symptom, that is cough or shortness of breath, and negative results from a WHO recommended laboratory test for SARS-CoV-2 from at least 2 consecutive respiratory specimens collected 24 hours or more apart, total 2 negative specimens. Then they can go back to their work. In case of asymptomatic healthcare workers with confirmed COVID-19 exposure who are returning to work, there are 2 strategies. One is time-based strategy, another is test-based strategy. Time-based strategy includes they should be excluded from work until 10 days have passed since the date of their first positive COVID-19 diagnostic test. If they are symptom-free but they are COVID-19 positive, so at least 10 days should pass after the diagnostic test. Assuming that they have not subsequently developed symptoms, if they develop symptoms, then further delay should be taken. But if they do not develop symptom since their positive test, then 10 days will be enough. If they develop symptoms, then the symptom-based or test-based strategy should be used. Test-based strategy exclude from work until negative results from a WHO recommended laboratory test for SARS-CoV-2 from at least 2 consecutive respiratory specimens collected more than 24 hours or equal to 24 hours apart, that is total 2 negative specimens. Now, we will talk about the surgical procedure. American College of Surgeons has developed a policy of trials of non-emergency surgical procedures. So in that case, when it is not emergency surgery or not semi-emergency surgery, routine surgery, in that case, risk versus benefit ratio must be judged. And the hospital and surgery center should consider both their patients' medical needs and their logistical capability to meet those needs in real time. The medical need for a given procedure should be established by a surgeon with direct expertise in the relevant surgical specialty. Logistical feasibility for a procedure should be determined by administrative personnel with an understanding of hospital and community limitation, considering facility resources and providers and community safety and well-being. Case conduct should be determined on the basis of a merger of these assessment tools using contemporary knowledge of the evolving national, local, or regional condition and recognizing that marked regional variation may lead to differences in regional decision making. Evaluation of patient risk should take into account both the real risk of the proceeding and the real risk of delay, including the expectation that a delay of 6 to 8 weeks or more may be necessary. This is taken from this eMedicine Mediscape, May 20, 2020. General principles for surgery. For surgical procedure, some general principles are to be followed. So in triaging elective cases, prepare for the expected markedly increased rates of COVID-19 because it is on the rise, in particular in our country now. Ensure that the patients receive appropriate and timely surgical care, including operative management on the basis of sound surgical judgment and resource availability. Consider non-operative management whenever it is clinically appropriate. Consider waiting on results of COVID-19 testing in patients who may be infected. Whenever possible, avoid emergency surgical procedures at night. For patients who are or may be infected, perform aerosol generating procedure, that is intubation, extubation, bronchoscopy, bag masking, electrocauterization, laparoscopy or endoscopy, only while wearing full PPE, including N95 mask or powered air purifying respirator, PAPR, designed for the operating room. So extreme precaution should be undertaken in dealing with this type of patient. Surgeon safety before, during, and after an operation. Personal protective equipment. Use of PPE is recommended by the Center for Disease Control and Prevention for every operative procedure performed on a patient with confirmed COVID-19 infection or a patient in whom there is a suspicion for infection. N95 respirators are respirators that offer a higher level of protection, should be used when one is performing or present for an aerosol generating procedure. For example, in the operating room, during patient intubation, in a patient with confirmed or suspected COVID-19 case. Disposable respirators and face masks should be removed and discarded appropriately in accordance with the local policy. Hand hygiene should be performed after the respirator and face mask is discarded. CDC videos for donning and doffing personal protective N95 mask, that is donning and doffing videos, are helpful. Fit testing is of paramount importance to ensure proper mask fit. Intubation risk. This is a very high risk condition because aerosolization and droplet transmission of the COVID-19 virus are important hazards for surgical personnel. These hazards increase with procedures such as endotracheal intubation, tracheostomy, gastrointestinal endoscopy, evacuation of pneumoperitoneum, particularly after laparoscopic surgery, and aspiration of body fluid during laparoscopic procedures. Surgeons and personnel not needed for intubation should remain outside the OR until anesthesia, induction, and intubation are completed for patient with or suspected of having COVID-19 infection. Negative pressure OR or operating rooms when available are recommended. Consideration should be given to how long COVID-19 might remain infectious on different surfaces. For example, 1 day on cardboard, 3 to 4 days on plastic, etc. This time should be followed. Specific operative risk issues. The minimum number of personnel should be in the operating room, including during intubation as well as throughout the procedure. No visitors or observers should be allowed. A smoke evacuator should be employed when an electrocautery is used. Consideration should be given to avoid laparoscopy. Tracheostomy considerations are important to take into account because high risk for aerosolization. After operation or recovery, if transport of a patient with or suspected of having COVID-19 to an outside recovery area or intensive care unit is necessary, hand off to a minimum number of transport personnel who are waiting outside the operating room should be considered. Personnel should wear PPE as recommended by the CDC. Such PPE should not be the same as that worn during the procedure. Recommendation for surgeon protection before and after separation from a patient with or without suspected of having COVID-19 infection vary from institution to institution. But the following are the general principle that should be stringently followed. Remove clothes on from home and keep in garment bag. Wear scrub clothes after arriving at hospital. After separating from the patient, remove scrub clothes. Consider showering before changing into a clean scrub suit or home clothes. Wash hand frequently and maintain safe social distancing. Going home, keeping family safe. Healthcare institution and system make hotel accommodation available for healthcare workers who cannot or prefer not to go home after the patient care activities. Remember that viral contamination of surfaces is a known means of transmission of infection. Keep hand sanitizer, disposable gloves, or both for use with ATM machine, vending machine, gasoline pumps, person-to-person transfer of purchased items. Clean cell phones frequently before, during, and after patient care activities. Cell phones may be kept in a reclosable plastic bag during work activities. This phone can be used while in the bag. Consider removing clothes and washing them upon arrival home. Consider reducing physical contact with family members and wash hands frequently. Clean hard surfaces at home with effective disinfectant solution, particularly containing 60% alcohol. Whenever there is emergency situation at the point of care, particularly in trauma patient, the following procedures should be maintained. Recommendation for trauma patient or trauma bay include the following. Do not delay trauma patient evacuation to determine COVID-19 status, but take appropriate precaution. There should not be delay in dealing with this type of emergency patient. They should be evacuated as early as possible. Ensure strict use of PPE for droplet contact precaution for all patients. They should be considered as potentially a COVID-19 patient unless otherwise proved. If a patient has upper respiratory symptom, immediately place a face mask on the patient. At question about fever, upper respiratory symptom, COVID-19 exposure history and travel history to the history and take appropriate isolation measures. Limit the number of personnel at the bedside of this required for direct patient care. Develop policies and procedures for airway management for potential COVID-19 patient requiring emergency intubation. Recommendation for the OR include the following. Develop a hospital policy for managing patient in the operating room with known or suspected of COVID-19 infection and prevent delays in critical operative intervention for unstable patient. There should not be delay. Ensure agreement are in place with the anesthesia team for management of this patient. The recommendation for the ICU include the following. Maintain situational awareness of the ICU capacity in the hospital and ensure that critical care needs of trauma patients are considered. Monitor the availability of ventilators and oxygen supply. Timing for reopening of elective surgery. When to start elective surgery again? There must be sustained reduction of rate of new COVID-19 cases in the relevant geographical area for at least 14 days before resumption of elective surgical procedures. Any resumption should be authorized by the appropriate municipality, country, and state health authorities. Facilities in the state or area must be safely able to treat all patients requiring hospitalization without resorting to crisis standard of care. Questions to be answered before reopening elective surgery. Does the facility have appropriate number of ICU or non-ICU beds, as well as sufficient supply of PPE, ventilators, medications, anesthetics, and all medical surgical supplies? Does the facility have available number of trained or educated staff appropriate for the planned surgical procedures, patient population, and facility resources? Given the known evidence supporting healthcare worker fatigue and the impact of stress, can the facilities perform planned procedures without compromising patient safety or staff safety or well-being? So all these questions should be answered before resumption of elective surgery. Now about personal protective equipment. Facilities should not resume elective surgical procedures until they have adequate PPE or medical surgical supplies. Facility policies regarding PPE should take the following considerations into account. Adequacy of available PPE, including supplies required for a potential second wave of COVID-19 cases. Staff training on and proper use of PPE according to non-crisis level evidence-based standard of care. Development of policies for conservation of PPE and for extended use and reuse of PPE per CDC guideline. Case prioritization and scheduling. Previously cancelled and postponed cases, when they should be operated again. Objective priority scoring. Specialist prioritization, depending upon the surgical specialties, specialist, they will consider the prioritization. For example, when to start the cancer surgery, organ transplant, cardiac, trauma patient, etc. Strategy for allotting daytime, operating room or procedural time. That is block time or prioritization by case type. So the time allocation is also important and the resources allocation is also important. Identification of essential healthcare professionals and medical device representatives per procedure. So strategy for phased opening. So depending upon the capability of the healthcare facilities and the institution, for example, initially we can start with 25% of the cases, then 50%, and gradually you can resume to full 100% of the cases. Strategy for increasing availability of OR and procedural time. So we can work for extended time before weekend to meet up the demand. Issues associated with increased OR or procedural volume. So personnel, logistic, and prioritization, this should be considered depending upon the local policy undertaken by the healthcare workers. General protection of healthcare workers. So a hospital dress code that should be followed. There are some standard mode of dresses that should be followed strictly. I'm not going into detail. There are some principles, certain principles which should be followed in all time. That is, soiled scraps or hats should be sensed as soon as possible. And certainly prior to speaking with family members after the surgical procedure. Scrub hats or caps worn during the dirty and contaminated cases should be changed prior to subsequent cases, even if not visibly soiled. Mask should not be worn dangling at any time. Operating room scrubs should not be worn in a hospital facility outside the operating room area without a clean lab coat or a prepared cover-up over them. Operating room scrubs should not be worn at any time outside of the hospital perimeter. Operating room scrubs should be changed at least daily. During invasive procedures, the mouth, nose, and hair, that is the skull and the face, should be covered to avoid potential wound contamination. Large sideburns and ponytails should be covered and contained. Earrings, jewelry worn on the head and neck where they may or might fall into or contaminate the sterile field should all be removed and appropriately covered during the procedure. The American College of Surgeons encourages clean, appropriate professional attire, not scrubs, to be worn during all patient encounter outside the operating room. So the video regarding the effective donning and doffing of PPE should be followed. There are certain principles that should be stringently followed. There are a lot of videos available on YouTube. You can follow any of them which follow the standard protocol. This website also has a very good video regarding donning and doffing of PPE. You can follow this one also. Mask. The allowance of surgical mask made more sense when scientists initially thought the virus was spread by large droplets. But a growing body of research shows that it is spread by minuscule viral particles that can linger in the air for as long as 16 hours. A properly fitted N95 respirator, which blocks 95% of the tiny air particle down to 0.3 micron in diameter, which are the hardest to catch from reaching the wearer face, should be worn, particularly whenever there is any aerosol generating procedure and when the nasal or oropharyngeal area is exposed to the personnel. But surgical masks designed to protect patients from the surgeon's respiratory droplets are not effective at blocking particles smaller than 100 microns, according to the Maskmaker 3M. A COVID-19 particle is smaller than 0.1 micron, but the droplet size is around 10 to 20 micron, according to South Korean researchers, and can pass through a surgical mask, but not through a N95 mask. So whenever there is high risk, a N95 mask should be followed. N95 respirator, better called, should be owned. For the laboratory workers, the biosafety levels should be followed. We know that there are four level of biosafety level. These are biosafety level 1, 2, 3, and 4. And depending upon the pathogenicity and risk of infection, this should be followed. In case of COVID-19, at least biosafety level 2 or 3 should be followed. So in 2, we saw see that the limited access space, equipment, and waste decontamination after use should be followed. And in biosafety level 3, access through airlock, negative air pressure, air not recirculated, class 3 clothing is required, and equipment and waste decontaminated after use should be followed. Strategy level for prevention of infection. Clean and decontaminate all equipment after use, sterilize, or use high-level disinfection for all items that come into direct or indirect contact with the mucous membrane. Rinse and dry items that have been chemically disinfected. Package and store items to prevent contamination before use. Keep environment clean, dry, and dust-free. Clean the wall and ceiling with bacillocid solution 1%. AC dust and vents should be cleaned. Mop the beds and mattresses with bacillocid 1%. Mopping should be done for air beds unless contraindicated by manufacturer's instruction. Floor should be scrubbed with water and detergent and then mopped with bacillocid. It's a hypochlorite containing solution, bacillocid 1%. Suction jars and humidifiers should be cleaned with soap and water. Corsolex or dipped in sodium hypochlorite 1% for 45 minutes and sent for ETO, ethylene oxide autoclaving. All equipment, clinical and non-clinical, are mopped with disinfectant. Biomedical staff is responsible for cleaning of all electronic equipment with bacillocil 25. COVID-95 is an enveloped virus. COVID-19 is an enveloped virus. There are differences because the naked viruses are less susceptible to this type of disinfection. They're difficult to clear. So enveloped virus, we can kill it with 70% alcohol, with sodium hypochlorite, bleach. Environmental Protection Agency registered disinfectant should always be used to disinfect these viruses. Naked viruses are very difficult to kill. These are killed or disintegrated by accelerated hydrogen peroxide, which is a mixture of 2% urea, 2% citric acid in 70% alcohol, or 1.8% crude aldehyde. They are used for disintegrating this type of naked viruses. Always the universal precaution should be followed, but this universal precautions has been strengthened further and expanded further to standard precaution. In universal precaution, what are the things we follow? We should use barrier protection to prevent skin and mucous membrane contact with blood and other body fluid. Wear gloves to prevent contact with blood, infectious materials, and other potentially contaminated surfaces or items. Wear face protection if blood or body fluid droplets may be generated during a procedure. Wear protective clothing if blood or body fluid may be splashed during a procedure. Wash hands and skin immediately and thoroughly if contaminated with blood and body fluid. Wash hands immediately after gloves are removed. Use care when using or handling sharp instruments and needles. Place used sharps in labeled puncture resistant containers. If you have sustained an exposure or puncture wound, immediately flush the exposed area and notify your supervisor. So in standard precaution, this universal precaution should always be followed, but in addition to that, some other procedures should also be followed. So in standard precaution, it should always be followed that the all body secretion except sweat are potential source of infection. So blood, including dried blood, all other body fluids, secretion, excretion, except sweat, are taken for universal precaution. Non-intact skin, any breakage in the skin or mucous membrane, even if it is not broken, they should be considered as potential source of infection. All patients, unless otherwise diagnosed as COVID negative, should be taken as a potential source of infection. So it is not that the patient and the healthcare community should be protected, but all the attendants of the patient should also be cared for so that they do not suffer from transmission of infection. And the stringent policy of medical waste disposal should be followed. We know there are five ways of treating medical waste. These are incineration, thermal or autoclaving, irradiative, that is microwave, destruction, chemical decontamination, or biological or enzymaticization. So depending upon the situation, all these policies should be adopted. And according to the different types of hazards impinged upon by these medical wastes, the policy should be followed. So sharps, they should be kept in this red jar, red bin. Biohazard material, they should be with this this type of packet, and biohazard label should be there. Trace chemo, they should be in a separate bin. Similarly, radioactive, they should be within the shielded container with radioactive symbol. Accordingly, this type of different types of measures should be undertaken in treating the medical waste. And this red medical wastes, they should be kept in two plastic bags, and they should be sealed by a protected healthcare worker. And these two bags should be sealed, and thereafter they should be subjected to either different types of mechanism. Before sealing, they should be chemically treated, like bleaching powder or sodium hypochlorite solution, and they should be sealed and either dumped into deep burial or can be incinerated depending upon the situation. So depending upon the situation, there should be either secured landfilling, deep burial, or some items may be recycled depending upon the situation after chemically treating it with 1% chlorine solution. So these different types of measures are undertaken depending upon the medical wastes, types of medical wastes. So all these policies should be followed. All these policies should be followed, and to keep our healthcare workers safe. It's a mandatory procedure and it's a necessity because healthcare workers are dying, particularly in our country, they're dying much. Not only the doctors, all the healthcare professionals like the nurses, the other ancillary workers, lab workers, cleaners, etc., all should be protected from this type of hazards. So thank you very much for kind listening. I think this will be useful.